My name is Jay Jordan, and I hope everyone is staying dry this morning. If you're in Greenville, it's a little wet out. But anyway, so today we're going to talk a little bit about hearing conservation. We'll go over numerous topics, you know, talking about the programs, and we'll talk about testing and what's required of hearing conservation. But with that being said, I'm going to talk a little bit just to introduce myself. So again, my name is Jay Jordan. I'm a senior consultant with Life and Safety. I've been working with Life and Safety for about a year and a half now. These guys, I've been doing safety for about 5 years. I started out in construction safety, kind of working at mostly automotive plants. But then I kind of transferred into the general industry when working with Life and Safety. So I kind of have experience, you know, so anyway. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So we do have some goals that we will cover in this webinar. We're going to try to recognize the need for hearing protection, being familiar with the employer's what is required of your program, understanding the nature of noise and how to reduce it, learn the components of a hearing protection program, we're going to talk about some noise monitoring, hearing assessments, and how to select the correct PPE, like noise reduction, stuff like that. So we'll go over that. Employer responsibilities regarding record keeping and training and so forth. All right. All right, so we're going to start talking about the need for a workplace hearing conservation, what regulations and requirements are required for that program, how it's created, how to come about, how to create this this program, how to do a baseline environmental noise study, audiometric testing, how does that work? We'll talk about that. The record keeping, record retention, and also transfer. We'll touch on that a little bit as well. We'll talk about the types of hearing protection. You know, what type of hearing protection is actually going to suit your industry the best. And then we'll talk about the annual hearing conservation training. So this next slide, you can kind of see these are just some stats from OSHA, from NIOSH. About 25% of all workers have been exposed to hazardous noise, whether or not they know it or not. With 14%, that's 22 million exposed in the last year. So we're talking about a large number here. 53% of noise exposed workers report not wearing hearing protection. It could be that they don't think about wearing it. It could be that the employer is not providing it for them, therefore they're not wearing it. So there's a lot of different factors in that. Hearing loss and tinnitus, approximately 12% of all workers have hearing difficulty. Now again, that could be due to what they're exposed to at work or other exposures while not at work. We'll talk about that as well. About 8% of all workers have tinnitus, so they have that ringing in their ears. And about 16% of noise-exposed tested workers have a material hearing impairment, whether that be, you know, damaged eardrums or damaged ear components. Hearing impairment is hearing loss that impacts day-to-day activities. It's not only going to affect these individuals at work, it's also going to affect them in their daily lives. So we want to make sure that we are looking out for our employees and that we are protecting them as much as we can, because, you know, that's kind of our that's kind of the employer's responsibility as well. So so what exactly is sound? We'll kind of touch on this here. So frequency or pitch is measured in hertz. And then you've got the pressure or the loudness, which is measured in decibels. So you got frequency and pressure of a sound wave with duration of exposure determine the risk of hearing loss. So depending on the pitch or the frequency and the pressure, it can determine, you know, what what risk you are taking for hearing loss. And we'll talk, I'm gonna show y'all a sample audiometric test here in a little while. So you'll kind of understand that more when I go over that. Noise sources. This is obviously not an all encompassing list, but machinery, tools, equipment, mechanical, you got pneumatic, you've got hydraulics, electrical, buzzing, stuff like that. It could be continuous or intermittent. It doesn't have to be continuous. It can be, you know, intermittent sounds, you know, maybe like a conveyor system or something going through its process. Also, low frequency noise often penetrates and travels more than high frequency noise. So, you know, depending on the frequency and depending on what is creating this noise, we want to make sure that we're pinpointing this source so that we can either engineer it out or protect these employees some way, somehow. Indicators of high noise levels. I see this a lot in, especially in construction. When we're working next to heavy equipment, sometimes you can't hear the other person standing next to you. So that right there is your first indication that you may be experiencing high noise levels. A lot of people say, well, what is high noise levels? So at 80 decibels, you have to speak pretty loud for someone to hear. From 85 to 90 decibels, if that noise is going around you, you're going to have to shout to somebody for them to actually hear you clearly. And then anything over 95, people have to move closer together to hear each other at all. So that's a good indicator if you have to start raising your voice for normal conversation to be heard. That's a good indicator that you do have some exposure of high noise levels. How is noise hazardous? Noise can result in temporary or permanent hearing loss. I'm sure that we've all experienced, if you're next to, say you're at a concert and you're next to a speaker, when you leave that concert, your ears are going to be ringing. That you might have some permanent hearing loss, but you definitely will have some temporary hearing loss from that. Let's say, you hear like a loud boom or something like that, you know, your ears could start ringing for a couple of moments and then go away. So that would be temporary. But you never know, there could be underlying permanent hearing loss as well going on behind that. So it can also, noise can cause you to misunderstand communication. We all know that communication is key in all facets of life, but especially at work, we wanna make sure that we're communicating properly and that we're getting that information across clearly. So we wanna make sure that people can hear. It can cause you to miss important safety warnings. You might not hear the backup alarm of a forklift or something along those lines. So it's important in that way. It can create unhealthy stress. You know, again, like I said, hearing loss doesn't only affect your workplace, but it can also affect your home life. So you could be stressed out from other factors as well. Loss of sleep, difficulty concentrating, fatigue, and then reduced efficiency. If all these things are working together, we're not going to be as efficient, right? So if we're not sleeping, we're not concentrating, and we're tired due to this hearing loss, you know, we're not going to be as effective as we could be. How do we hear? So I'm no doctor, but we do have kind of a basic diagram here of how the eardrum is made, or how the ear is made up. You've got your eardrum, your ear canal. Obviously, sound goes through your ear canal and vibrates from the eardrum and passes along these small bones. Obviously, the ear is very, very fragile. And so these components can be damaged quickly and easily. You've got your what's called a cochlea, and there are cochlear hairs inside of that nautilus-looking cochlea there. And if you damage those hairs, that is kind of how hearing loss, that's how we hear sound. But if you start to damage those hairs, then you would start to have some sort of hearing loss. From there, the auditory nerve sends signals to the brain that are understood as sound. So that's how we can hear, basically. So that's just kind of a quick diagram. How hearing is damaged. So the hearing ability relies on delicate parts. Again, we want to make, this is why we're trying to protect our ear, because it is delicate and it can be damaged easily. Hearing ability relies on delicate parts that can be damaged in the inner and middle ear. The hair-like cells, like I was talking about earlier, the cochlear hairs can be flattened by high noise levels and injured. So once they're flattened, they don't stand back up and they don't vibrate and give us that sound. Hearing loss can be sudden, but it's normally gradual. As we get older, obviously our hearing goes out a little bit. I'll talk about this again, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself, but the audiometric testing does account for an age shift. So we'll touch on that. Hearing damage is permanent. We always say, we could wear hearing aids, but who wants to wear a hearing aid, right? We want to make sure that we're protecting our hearing as long as possible, because like we said, age and other factors, we're not going to hear as well as we did, 5 years ago. So it is permanent. So always keep that in mind. Once you lose it, you can't get it back. Not every case of hearing loss is caused by noise exposure. There could be other factors as well. You could have someone born without an eardrum or something like that, an abnormality. So it's not always just from noise exposure. It could be an abnormality. So hearing loss is defined as any reduction in the ability to hear. Two types of hearing loss, temporary, we talked about that, may occur immediately following a high noise exposure, but could fall off after a while. And then permanent hearing loss, which we will talk about what's called a standard threshold shift, or an STS. So there are some signs of hearing loss. If you start to exhibit some of these signs, there could be a potential for you having some sort of hearing loss. And obviously difficulty hearing people speak, inability to hear certain high-pitched or soft sounds. If you, say you're listening to the radio, you usually listen to it at a certain volume, and you start to notice that you can't hear it as well, or it seems a little bit distant, something like that. Also getting complaints that the radio or TV volume is too high. Sounds like my dad, whenever he's watching TV or something, it sounds like a concert in the next room. So, he has some sort of hearing loss. There are signs, and it doesn't have to be both ears. It could just be one ear that's starting to go out. So just always keep that in mind as well. All right, noise overexposure. So we're gonna talk about the exposure limits here. So noises are these noise assessments are measured on an 8-hour time-weighted average. So basically your 8-hour exposure limit should not exceed 85 decibels. And a single exposure, a loud bang or something like that, should not exceed 140 decibels, which is very loud. I think like a football stadium could be like 120 to 140 decibels. So you can imagine how loud 140 decibels is. Continuous exposure cannot exceed 115 decibels. Okay. So that's where you might need to, let's see, where is that table? Here it is. I'll show you that table here in a second, but, you could have a need for double hearing protection. You could have a need for, swapping out employees every hour, every 30 minutes, if that noise is exceeding a certain decibel level. OSHA does require employers to implement a hearing conservation program when noise exposure is at or above 85 decibels over that 8-hour time-weighted average, okay? So you can't just go out to the floor of your plant and have a dosimeter and say, oh goodness, it's 87 decibels. That's just a spot test. You're not actually, testing for that 8-hour period. So what we do is we can set up a noise sample, which it consists of, depending on, what department and where you want to test, There could be, you know, anywhere from one to, I don't know, 20 individuals that we're going to test. We basically will clip a dosimeter to that individual. And this dosimeter doesn't record like what they're saying. It just records the decibel levels around them. I get a lot of folks who say, I don't want to wear that because you're going to, you're recording what I'm saying. That's not what we're doing. We're just recording the noise levels around them. And basically we'll get, we'll do it for an eight to nine hour period. So we get a good sample. And then we send those in to get analyzed and get those results back. I'll show you here in a second, a chart on that as well. So going back to the permissible exposure. So you can see on the left, you have your hours per day. And then to the right, you'll see the decibel levels. So you can see like for 1 hour, you can only be exposed to 105 decibels. So that means that employee would need to either swap with somebody or rotate or take a break for a few minutes and then go back. So you can kind of see how these levels, you know, change during, you know, depending on the hours and depending on how many hours you're exposed to it. So you can see down at the bottom that, you know, 15 minutes or less, you know, it's 115 decibels. So, all right. When the permissible exposure limit is exceeded, administrative or engineering controls fail to reduce the noise level below that limit, the employer must provide hearing protection. So if we can't engineer it out, same thing if we're doing hazard assessments. If we can't administratively or engineer this this sound out to reduce the levels below that exposure, we have to provide hearing protection. Employee exposure to excessive noise is affected by a number of factors, obviously including the noise level, the duration, where they're working, if they're working in multiple departments, stuff like that. So there's multiple factors. As a part of a continuing effective hearing conservation program, employers must make a hearing protection available to all employees exposed to an 8 hour time weighted average of 85 or greater. So the 85 is kind of our sweet spot, sweet number. Okay. So if you do find that you have that time weighted average at 80 decibels, the best practice is to provide hearing protection, encourage proper use, and create a hearing conservation program. At 85 decibels, this is when you are required to have a hearing conservation program. That includes exposure monitoring, so testing the noise levels. That should be every 2 years. Training, so you wanna make sure that you're training your employees. They need to know how to don this PPE, what PPE to choose, certain things like that, and how you lose hearing, stuff like that. And then also your audiometric hearing tests. Hearing protection must be made available and is required for any individuals who have experienced a standard threshold shift. So if you do your what's called a baseline test, the baseline test is the first test that that we do. So say you've never done a hearing conservation program before, we could come in and, you know, test all of your employees, and that is your baseline. So your baseline is what we will then compare and contrast each new test with, just to make sure there hasn't been any large shifts. Now, at night, if you're exposed to 90 decibels or higher, OSHA requires that hearing protection is worn. So back here, 85 decibels, it requires a hearing conservation program. At 90, it is required that they wear hearing protection, and to evaluate engineering and administrative controls. Because, you know, if we do, you know, encase an area with soundproof glass or something like that, it still could be loud. We still might need to wear hearing protection, even though we have an engineering control. So stuff like that. Employers must supply hearing protection at no cost. So PPE is always provided by the employer. Provide a variety of hearing protection because not everyone's ears are the same. Not everybody hears the same. Not everyone has the same ear canal makeup. So we'll talk about different types of hearing protection here in a second. Because for me personally, I can't wear the silicone plugs because they irritate my ears. So I have to use the foam expanding plugs. So, you know, depending on the person, they might need to use something different. Evaluate the effectiveness and assure proper use. So that's where that training comes in. So the elements of a hearing conservation program is going to explain the responsibilities of the employer and the employee. We'll also have hazard identification and exposure monitoring. We'll know what the decibel exposure is. Control methods, hierarchy of controls, and hearing protection devices selection, use and maintenance. We want to make sure that we choose the right one, that we're using it properly, and that we're maintaining it. Because maintaining this PPE is important. Audiometric testing once a year. Hazard communication, education, and training. Also, some sort of signage could also be you're entering a loud environment, something like that. Record keeping, we all know OSHA loves record keeping, so that's important. And then continuous monitoring and improvement. So always, maybe annually, just reviewing your program, making necessary changes, adding, subtracting, stuff like that. So evaluating noise exposure, as we said, conducting that noise survey, and identify impacted employees. There could be some employees that are working in the same department, but one person is affected more than another. And that's when those dosimeters really come into play, because one individual could be working at a CNC machine, and then the guy right next to him could be working at a desk, and he's not as exposed, but they're in the same department. What environmental noise testing reveals? So testing is conducted again over that 8-hour period, done with dosimeters. We gather that data and we'll send it off, and then we'll basically compile all that and see which departments, which areas are at risk or are higher than others. And then we can go in and create a plan on, you know, how we can either engineer it out or start that hearing conservation program. Test reports summarize and tabulate collected data and offer recommendations. So as you can see here, this is just an example spreadsheet. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have 10 individuals that were tested. As you can see, there's different departments. Well, mostly welding and assembly, but there are two separate departments, so that's good. You'll see the job task, where they are in that department. And then you'll also notice the runtime. We want to keep it between close to 8 hours, but you know, as long as you get it close to 8 hours, you should be fine. You don't want to do, you know, 6 hours, 5 hours, something like that, but as close to 8 hours as possible. Then you'll see your average there. So 83.4, 83.9. So none of these actually are over the 85 threshold, but 80 decibels and higher, it is recommended, or I would recommend going ahead and creating a hearing conservation program because you are pretty close to the threshold. One decibel, two decibels, you know, can make a difference, but you know, you want to make sure that that you're protecting your employees. And then we'll talk about the noise reduction rating here in a second. You'll see those numbers 34, 33, 31, 29. Those numbers you'll see on hearing protection, like plugs, they'll say, oh, this has a noise reduction rating of 29. And I'll talk to you here about how to calculate that here in a second. All right, so the audiometric exams. So for employees working in environments covered by a hearing protection program, within that 6 months of their first exposure, they should be tested. It says mobile test van. We don't actually hear it at Life and Safety. We have something, a program that we use, a tablet, and then we just have to find a very quiet area so that we can we can test employees, and it actually moves a lot quicker, and it's a little bit more effective. So it's, you know, thank you for technology, right? So testing set up annually, so you want to do this every year, can be done at a fixed site, or an evaluator can come to you. We generally will come, you know, come to the client and perform these tests. Generally takes 15 minutes per person, can take, depending on the person, you know, again, not everyone has the same hearing levels. You know, before we'll first go through like a questionnaire, just asking about their exposure history, their hearing history, stuff like that. And then we go through the actual test. So it can take anywhere from 15 to, you know, I've had one take, you know, 30 minutes. So not too long, but, you know, when you're doing, you know, 40 or 50 in a day, you know, it is important just to kind of keep it rolling. But all right. So here we can see John Doe's audiometric testing result. So you got your right ear on the left and your left ear on the right, which makes a lot of sense, right? So you got your right ear here. You can see the gray line there. That is their baseline test, okay? And also on the left ear, the gray line is their baseline. The red and blue is the test that they just did. So you can see it did that John's hearing did shift on the right ear about 10 decibels. You can see at the top, it says recordable STS 10. And then on the left ear, he also had a recordable shift at 15 decibels. This is the program that we use. This is exactly what you see after a test. So it's a real time thing. So we will go over the testing results with the individual or the candidate, and just to kind of inform them, you know, and then there is an option for them to have the results sent to them as well. So what is a standard threshold shift? Hearing loss has occurred if you have experienced a standard threshold shift. An STS is a change in hearing threshold relative to the baseline audiogram, that gray line that we were talking about, of an average of 10 decibels or more, okay? So at that 2,000, 3,000, or 4,000 hertz in either ear. So if we see that shift, it will alert us. And there is a protocol here. So if you do receive a shift, we want to make sure that the employee is notified in writing of that shift within 21 days. Now you may retest within 30 days to validate or invalidate the test. So for example, I had an individual who we took a test and he had a recordable shift in one of his ears, but it was very significant. And I thought that was kind of weird. Usually within 1 year, you're not going to, I think it was like 40 decibels. It was a lot. And you don't normally see that. So I let the individual know. I told him to say, hey, I'm going to come back and, you know, next visit within like 15 days and we'll retest you just to see, you know, if this was, you know, not a reputable test. So what we did is we retested him, and what happened was he didn't actually understand how to alert me if he heard a sound or not. So there's a lot of different factors. It could be that he was exposed to noise right before he came in. We always try to, you know, test the individuals before they start work, obviously, because we don't want them to be exposed right before a test, but sometimes that's not feasible. But you know, there's a lot of ways that an invalid test could happen. So, you know, we can retest, so that's good. An employee will then be referred to a physician, an audiologist, or an otolaryngologist for an evaluation. So you don't want to scare them in any way and say, oh, you know, you've lost all your hearing. It's like, no, you know, we found these results. This is what you can and can't hear. Let's send you to a physician and they will do further testing. Employees not already required to use hearing protection will then be fitted, trained, and required to use them. Any employees already required to wearing hearing protection will be refitted and retrained. so that they understand exactly what they should be doing. And then if subsequent testing shows a shift is not present, hearing protection can be discontinued or maintained as required. So just depending on the situation, you know, you could take it away or keep it in place. Record retention and transfer. The employer shall retain records for the following durations. Any of the noise exposure measurements, so these noise samples, you want to retain those for 2 years. And the audiometric tests should be retained for the duration of the employee's employment. So if they're there for 30 years, you should have 30 tests for them, okay? All records should be made available to that employee. Access to medical records, all employees have access to their medical records. The employer, this last one, I haven't seen this happen very often, but it would be a nice thing. The employer should transfer all required records to a subsequent employer should the initial employer cease business. That could be one of the least of their worries if, you know, if they're ceasing business, but, you know, it would be, you can transfer this data from one employer to the next, so you don't have to redo a baseline test for that employee at that new company. All right. Hearing protection and noise reduction. So that NRR that we were talking about earlier, this is how you calculate it. So basically say NRR calculations applied to noise exposure limits with a PPE NRR of 25. So this is an example. So what we'll do is we'll take 7 away from 25. That takes it down to 18 decibels, right? Then we'll take that 18 and subtract it from the 90 decibels, right? So that's our exposure level. So basically all we're doing is we're reducing that 90 decibels down to that, or we're reducing it 18 decibels down to 72 decibels. All right. Now OSHA has an alternate noise reduction calculation. This is going off of a less than ideal usage and conditions. So many situations prevent optimal performance of PPE, including improper use, poor maintenance, also selecting the wrong type of PPE or hearing protection. So OSHA has this this new calculation. This is the one that I would suggest to go by, just because it is, you know, per OSHA. So you want to subtract 7 again. So take that 25 minus 7, 18. Then you divide that by 2. So you basically take out half, and then you subtract that value again from that 90. So 90 minus 9, 81. So you are below that 85 threshold there. So 25, earplugs with an NRR of 25 would be safe for you to use in your plant. So the above value is the most likely real world reduction. So that's why I say go buy this one. It's a lot more real, I guess. So just to review, hearing protection devices must reduce employee noise exposure below an 8-hour time weighted average of 90 decibels. Employees with a standard shift exposure. So if we noticed a standard shift from their baseline test, they should be reduced below an 8-hour time weighted average of 85 decibels. All right, how to properly wear earplugs? We want to make sure that we're actually sealing the ear canal. So for these foam plugs, you basically just want to roll them in your fingers, create a kind of make them compressed, and then open your ear by pulling the top of your ear up and back. That'll open your ear canal. Then stick that foam plug into your ear while letting go of your earlobe, and you will feel that foam fill up your ear canal. And then just kind of touch it to make sure that it's in there secure and you're ready to roll. Should keep noise from reaching the eardrum. Do not use cotton as an earplug, okay? The foam plugs, they got silicone plugs now. They have all kinds. Even these specially molded earplugs, custom fitted. These are a little bit more expensive, but these are reusable and they're pretty durable. They're not gonna. If you're paying all this money for them, they better work and they better be reusable. So So anyway, that's another option. If you know, if you're experiencing someone who cannot wear certain types of hearing protection. Also, we can wear earmuffs. We want to make sure that they're sealed against the head with your ears fully in there. You don't want your earlobe or anything sticking out. Keeping the hair out of your earmuffs, or not earmuffs, earmuffs. Assure that your other PPE, if you're wearing a hard hat, if you're wearing glasses, if you're wearing a Tyvek suit or something like that, you want to make sure that your PPE is not interfering with each other. Okay. You want to make sure that they're operating to their maximum potential. So just making sure that this isn't affecting any other type of PPE, making sure the headband works well. And when I've worked some places where they only have a set of earmuffs for one, you know, for that department. So if you are using them, you know, if multiple employees are using them, making sure we're keeping them clean, and we're just maintaining them, looking for any cracks, cracks in the seal, or looking, making sure that headband is actually working well. Any other options and other considerations? Some noisy environments require earplug use under earmuffs, so a double hearing protection. So keep that in mind. OSHA does not condone noise canceling headphones. I have a lot of people, like when I do the audiometric testing, I'll say, you know, what type of hearing protection do you wear at work? And they'll say, oh, well, I wear my earbuds. It's like, well, those are not here. That's not hearing protection. They're like, well, they're noise canceling. It's like, well, no, that's not it. So if someone's saying, oh, well, you know, it's noise canceling, you know, because it could be noise canceling, but you're also listening to music. And if it's loud, if it's a loud environment, you're going to have to turn that music up to hear it. So you're just exposing yourself to more noise, really. Earbuds, not earplugs, may be desired by employees, but are often inadequate. Again, these do not have any NRR ratings. You know, music or talking to somebody on the phone could be distracting. And again, you might have a policy in place where you don't use your cell phone, you can't use headphones, stuff like that. So just keep that in mind. Earbuds, noise canceling headphones are not hearing protection. Again, we always know that the employer provides this equipment and options, and making sure that these employees have the correct options. Again, like we said, not everybody's the same, so we're going to have different types of protection. Employer does provide the training, as we talked about earlier. They are required to provide training on proper use and how hearing works and how hearing loss can happen. Training should be repeated annually. So this is something that we go over generally in our audiometric testing. We will talk to individuals about wearing PPE in high exposure levels. But it's always good to have an annual training just as a refresher. Okay. Training must include effects of noise on hearing, the purpose of hearing protectors, and then instructions on selection, fitting, and how to use them. All right, that is it. If you have any questions, please put it in the chat box below. And just here, we do have some more links. Links to just the different websites where you can learn. If you want to learn more, you can peruse these.
All right, that was some fantastic information, Jay. Thank you. I do have a few questions that have come through. I know you mentioned it takes about 10, 15, 20 minutes per employee. If a company has, say, 20 employees or 100 employees, in your experience, how long does it take to get through that number of people?
Good question. So again, it depends on, so you really have to have a good plan in place on, I guess, filtering or, you know, sifting through the individuals. So you want to have, you know, you're in constant contact with a supervisor or something like that. So keeping a good flow of people coming through is really important, I've found. So again, communication is key. And then, like I said, it depends. But I would say in general, in an 8-hour period, I can do about almost 40 per 8-hour period. So, you know, if you've got, I've done more than that, but, it was just a really, really quick, quick flow. So that was good. But again, it just depends, but you know, usually 40 in a day.
Okay. All right. That's some good information. Another question. Is it possible through engineering controls or other methods to get rid of a hearing conservation program or to no longer require one? Basically, if you implement a hearing conservation program, do you have to keep it, or are there ways to mitigate or control it away?
Yeah, I mean, if you say you, like I was saying earlier, if you encase, say you have a machine that's vibrates very loud or something like that, and you encase it in glass, soundproof container or something like that, and then you redo the noise assessment, and you're below that threshold, then yeah, you could get rid of that hearing conservation program. You can discontinue it.
All right. We did just have a comment come through the chat window. It says, you mentioned using a tablet to do testing. What kind of tablets and any requirements or limitations for them?
It's an iPad. And we use a program called Shoebox. And basically what we have to do is before we start testing, we have to test the room, right? So say I come in, you give me an office that's not being used. Basically, I have a microphone that I plug in, and it runs through a series of frequencies and decibels and tests the room to see if it's quiet enough. And I will say it is pretty sensitive, like air handler units, beeping forklifts going by, stuff like that will affect the test. So the tablet will, throughout the testing, it will monitor the sound, and if it gets too loud, it pauses the test. Now it doesn't, you don't have to retake it, but it pauses it until that noise has been reduced. So, but yeah, it's actually really great. I mean, with the vans and everything, you do have a set area, but with this, you can go to different departments and you can actually kind of move a little bit faster. So.
Okay, good. All right. Do any of the links that you have on the screen have any type of samples or templates for the hearing conservation program?
I would think that if you go to the OSHA standard sites, they will at least have an outline on what you need. I don't know if there's an actual like template on any of these.
Okay.
But I can find that out Nathan, if you can figure out who it was, I can find out and I can send him some sort of template or something like that.
Sure. That might be something good for us to send with the post-event follow-up where we send out the link to everybody.
Sure.
All right. Well, I think that officially takes us to the end of our presentation. I'm going to take over the screen here for just a moment. I'd like to thank everybody who joined us today. Also, thank you especially, Jay, for that fantastic presentation on audiometric testing and hearing conservation programs. Again, this has been recorded and will be uploaded to our YouTube channel. Oh, we do have one more question that just came through. Here's a scenario. Let's say a sound level meter has been used in a location that you suspect employees are not exceeding the PEL and no dosimetry has been done. Can an employee decline annual audio testing after dosimetry has been done, which reveals that employees in the area are overexposed? Can they sign a declination? I'd see it as the employee not wanting to abide by PPE requirements.
That's a good question. Well, I mean, essentially, I might be interpreting the question wrong, but it sounds like you're saying that the employees are declining to wear the protection. That would be a violation of your hearing protection program, I would
say.
The
question was also asking, can the employee decline the audiometric testing after dosimetry has been done, which reveals the employees in the area are overexposed?
I would think they decline
a hearing test.
Oh, okay. That's a good question. I can, again, I might need to research that, but that's a real, I, I've not come across that before. I haven't had anyone decline an audiometric test before.
That's something it's as someone else is commenting in there. The short answer is no, it's a condition of employment. I would think that I would have to agree with that. If dosimetry testing has been done, shows that the sound levels are above the exposure level, I don't think an employee can decline a audiometric test at that point.
I mean, maybe they could, if they don't feel comfortable doing it at work, we can maybe give it an option, say, hey, if you want to go to your physician and do it that way. But that's a great question.
Hold on. SMG990U, is that Mr. Anthony Wilkes? I believe it is. So that's coming from our resident former OSHA person. So they are saying no, a person cannot decline an audiometric test if it is a condition of their employment that they adhere to your safety programs. So short answer, no, they cannot decline.
Thank you, Anthony.
I appreciate that. All right. Well, I think that takes us through our Q&A section. Excellent questions. Thank you for all of those. As you can see on the screen, we do have a few more webinars coming up in April. We're going to talk about ISO management systems. In May, heat stress. Also in May, we do have a special, now this is a paid for event in cooperation or in coordination with OSHA's annual safety stand down fall protection emphasis week. In May, we are running a fall protection class at Lockheed here in Greenville. That is for the first 4 hours of the day from 8 to noon. If you scan the QR code that's actually in the green box on the screen, that will take you to some information about that. We've not sent out any mass emails about it yet, so do keep your eye out for that. We're going to be advertising that to the general public here in the next couple of weeks. So again, thank you everyone so much for attending, for participating. Have a great weekend and stay safe out there.